Here?
They missed my conversation. I was telling him about the leather man. Anyways, this is Ralph Brill. He's been up here many years. This is our ninth year. I think he's been up here at least five of them. You know? Talking about goats, solar power, many things. Man of many ideas. And how many people know a little bit about the Greylock Glen? Oh yeah, okay, we got some Adams people here. Adams, anybody from Adams? No? Well, it's a sad tale, you know. You going to talk quite a bit about the history?
Well, a little bit, because we were talking about the future, so we were going to touch upon the past. And
Because, of course, I was a young man when they started the project. I'm still a young man, I know. But they started turning up the side of the mountain and create a ski area. And the guy ran out of money, and next thing you know, things fall apart. Various ideas, convention centers, whatever, you know, gambling.
Golf course.
Golf course. Golf course was active for a couple of years.
A few years, yeah.
And then that, for whatever reason.
Yeah, so we're going to get into that.
Oh, okay, very good.
Okay.
Ralph Brill, round of applause, thank you.
Good evening, everybody, and thank you for coming. It's a pretty day. Apologize for the technology. It was working fine 15 minutes ago, and then somehow something happened. Anyway, we're back on schedule. So, by way of background, I'm an architect, a licensed architect, and real estate developer, and a few other things, and have been involved in recreational projects in Telluride, Colorado, in the Hudson Valley of New York, in the Caribbean. And I have a gallery in North Adams, an art gallery, and I've been here about 10 years. I'm half the week here. This property intrigued me. I loved hiking on it, walking on it, exploring it, and so on. And then 2 years ago, there was discussion about the town wanting to see something happen there and making it into a campground. I said, well, that sounds fine. The Boy Scouts can do a good job or whatever they were going to do. But then it got a little bit more serious than that. So I'm going to give you a little background, because I don't know how many people here know about Adams and the historical part of it. So it once was called East Hoosuck. So that's apparently the Indian name of stones. And so that's where you get the Hoosac River and the Hoosac Mountains, and Hoosick eventually in the 1950s, it changed its name again. It became Adams in 1778. And then North Adams split from in 1878 or 1880 approximately, when the Hoosac Tunnel was built. Okay, so one of the big economic engines of this region, of course, were the cotton mills. And cotton came from slave plantations in Mississippi, and the Plunkets, who owned this, who were the major economic force in Adams, in fact, had their own slave plantations in Mississippi. Today, the only building that stands is this one here, and also this one. So there are two that stand, while the rest are down. It was a major economic powerhouse and employed thousands of child workers. That was another big part of the system in the 1800s and early 1900s. And eventually, the business phased out for a bunch of different reasons, and in the 1960s, many of us know that Warren Buffett bought it. That's where the name Berkshire Hathaway comes from this property in a way. So this was a very powerful engine. The banks were all located in Adams. The best stores were located here. I hope this keeps on wanting to So this is what inside those mills look like. Raw cotton came here and it was made into thread. The thread then was made into cloth. So this is 1882. This, of course, is Mount Greylock, and we're talking about this area here. What's interesting about it is that you can see it's pretty denuded because people use the wood for building, for firewood, for creating charcoal, and so on. So but you also can see that there are lots of beautiful architectural elements have been added to the landscape in Adams at that time. So this is McKinley. So why is there a statue of McKinley in Adams? So what the story is, of course, is that McKinley was an officer in the Civil War in Mississippi and bumped into the Plunkets who had slave plantations down there but also had their huge business interests here. And when the Civil War was over, why did he choose to go to law school in Albany as opposed to Ohio, which is where he's from? Again, the belief is because of the proximity and the connections to the Plunkets. And eventually he, meaning President McKinley, when he finally became president, one of the early things he did do was to protect the cotton pricing internationally. And so that figure of him standing on that statue is of him when he told the Senate, this is what I want, and that's why that statue has him standing in that certain kind of way. So these are some remnants today of what we're talking about. Of course, the train ran to the left, which brought the raw materials to the area. That's the Berkshire Mill remains. This is one of the other ones, and this is the little roof of the train station that was waiting for a train to eventually happen. But the other thing that you have surrounding Adams today, because the economy has disappeared, of course, are, you know, maybe 50 vacant storefronts. And you also have some gorgeous architecture. This really is like a European cathedral. It is so special. But just around the corner, you've got some more vacant structures. Locals, of course, use and enjoy the trail, and it is a main quality of life feature. For those of here who use it, I'm sure you get a lot of pleasure. But people eventually, hopefully, it goes all the way to Massmoka and through to Williamstown. That's the plan.
Excuse me, what trail are you talking about?
Ash to Wilcock.
Yeah, so we don't know about that.
It's the rail trail.
Oh, the rail trail where the train is running?
It's a bike path, yeah.
Yeah, so this... this
the train is to run, okay.
Yeah. So this presently is around 18 miles running from Pittsfield, the Berkshire Mill area, to about a mile north of there. So actually,
does it go to Lime Street now?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's hard to get real figures in this part of the world, but there's probably 100,000 plus people who do use this throughout the year. In the winter, people use it for cross country skiing and just walking. It's a real asset. So there's and this is the beautiful library, and McKinley is placed there because he helped build the library. So this is a map that's produced by the town. Can everybody see that well? This large green is the Mount Greylock Reservation. That's 12,500 acres approximately. And of course, we were on top of there right here. This darker green area is what's officially called the Glen, which is about a little over 1,000 acres. Anybody here familiar with Central Park? That's 850 acres, so this is a little bit bigger than Central Park. Yeah. Peter was suggesting, it has a history of a lot of bad starts. And I invited, once Peter asked me to do this talk about the Glen, I said, well, I'm going to invite the Historical Society to stand up here with me, and they can be much more informed than I could. And they said, no, we don't want to touch it. It has such a bad history, it makes us very upset to even think about it. So it's a curious history.